processes involved in both classical and operant conditioning. Session outline, processes involved in conditioning, gradual extinction, spontaneous recovery, stimulus generalization, stimulus discrimination. At the end of this module, you will be able to explain gradual extinction, spontaneous recovery, stimulus generalization, and stimulus discrimination. Hello students, we have learnt about classical conditioning and operant conditioning. There are some differences between these two kinds of conditioning, but there are the processes which are common in both. There are four processes which have been identified which are common to both classical and operant conditioning. They are gradual extinction, spontaneous recovery, stimulus generalization, and stimulus discrimination. Let us try to know about each of these. The first one is gradual extinction. The condition reflex action in classical conditioning continues only if we repeat the experiment or repeat the trials. Once the trials are discontinued, the condition reflex gradually disappears. This is called extinction. For example, Pavlovian dog learned to salivate at the sound of the bell because food and bell were given together. And if that continues to be given to the dog together, then only it will continue to salivate at the sound of the bell. But if you stop associating the bell with the food, over a period of time, gradually salivation at the sound of the bell will stop. This is called extinction, and since it happens gradually, it is called gradual extinction. Second process is spontaneous recovery. After the response becomes extinct, in the first step, gradual extinction, sometimes suddenly the dog was found to salivate at the sound of the bell. This shows that nothing is forgotten completely. Similarly, even in operant conditioning, if the rat is not given the practice of depressing the liver at the sound of the music, it will also stop depressing the bar at the sound of the music. But after some time, suddenly, spontaneously, the organism will remember the learned behavior. This is called spontaneous recovery. We can also relate to it. We may want to remember the name of a student whom we had as a colleague in a photo, and then we are not able to remember, and suddenly after many days, suddenly that name will strike you, or that photo you are able to recognize. So this shows that whatever we learn, we don't forget completely. Stimulus generalization. In both kinds of conditioning, whenever we give the organism the food, that is the unconditioned stimulus, whatever gets it the food, it will try to do, and in the beginning, it associates that with all the stimuli which are present at that given moment. For example, the Pavlovian dog associated in the beginning the food with all the stimuli which were present at the time of giving the food. The color of the light, the footsteps of the person who brings food, and also the bell. Later, to make the organism salivate only at the sound of the bell, the experimenter had to keep the bell constant with the food and vary the color of the light and the footsteps and other things. So whatever is constantly present along with the food, the organism associates with that and then gives the same response to both these stimuli. Even in operant conditioning, when the rat depresses the liver, it gets a food pellet. Then the rat generalizes and keeps on depressing the bar again and again in the hope of getting more and more food. The fourth process is stimulus discrimination. In the beginning, generalization happens, but later they try to discriminate and find out which one gets them actually the food and try to respond only to that. For example, in classical conditioning, the dog in the beginning associated food with the bell, the color of the light, the footsteps of the person who brought the food, but later realized that it was the bell which was only constant with the food and learned to discriminate between those stimuli and then associated food only with the bell. Similarly, Skinner's rat in the beginning went on depressing the bar, hoping that it will get more food, but then later when it did not, it learn to discriminate between the stimuli which brought it food and which did not give it food, and thereby associated food with the sound of the music which was coming, and it learned to depress the bar only when the music was also sounded. So these four processes are common to both kinds of conditioning. So students, we saw that there are four processes which operate in common in both classical and operant conditioning. First one is gradual extinction. Since it is essentially a process of habit formation, as long as we continue the trials and keep the experimentation phase constant, the expected conditioning results will also be present. The strength between the stimulus and the response gradually decreases when we discontinue the association between the stimulus and the response. Therefore, gradually, the things which are learnt will even become extinct gradually. This process is called gradual extinction. We have realized that mathematical tables or some numbers which we learn through rehearsal, we all forget over a period of time, similar to gradual extinction. The second process involved is spontaneous recovery. Though a connection between a stimulus and a response has been established and the organism has been conditioned to give a particular response, in both kinds of conditioning, when the trials are discontinued, even the strength between the stimulus and response also becomes weaker, and one day it becomes extinct. But to one's surprise, the organism suddenly shows the learnt response without any trial, all of a sudden, spontaneously. This shows that nothing is forgotten completely. The third one is stimulus generalization. The organism, when it finds out that there is a particular condition which is available at the time of response, it tries to give the same response over and over again. For example, in case of Pavlovian dog, the situation which was present was the food along with the particular kind of light and the bell and also the footsteps of the person who brought the food. The organism in the beginning associated food with all the three and salivated at each of these stimuli, but only the experimenter could manipulate which one was to remain constant. If the experimenter wanted, he could have even made the dog salivate at the footsteps of the person who brought the food or at the color of a light, but then he kept the bell constant along with the food. So the organism learnt later to discriminate, but before discrimination, the first step is stimulus generalization. Even in operant conditioning, we saw that the rat went on depressing the bar again and again in the hope of getting more food pellets. But later it discriminated and learned to press the lever only whenever the food was to come, that is, along with the sound of a music. Thus, these four processes, gradual extinction, spontaneous recovery, stimulus generalization and stimulus discrimination, are essential processes involved in classical and operant conditioning. Thank you.